What are the roots that clutch? What branches grow out of this stony rubbish? Son of man, you cannot say or guess, for you know only a heap of broken images where the sun beats. And the dead tree gives no shelter, the cricket no relief, and the dry stone no sound of water. Only there is shadow under this red rock. Come in under the shadow of this red rock, and I will show you something different from either your shadow at morning striding behind you, or your shadow at evening rising to meet you. I will show you fear in a handful of dust. Frisch weht der Wind der Heimat zu, mein irisch Kind, wo weilst du?
God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, Let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven. And the evening and the morning were the second day. And God said, Let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, Let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit trees yielding fruit under his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And God said, Let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping thing, and beast of the earth after his kind. And it was so. And God made the beast of the earth after his kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the earth after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And God said, Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the seas, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. A man adrift on a slim spar, a horizon smaller than the rim of a bottle, tented waves rearing lashy dark points, the near white of froth in circles, God is cold. The incessant raise and swing of the sea, and growl after growl of crest, the sinkings green, seething, endless, the upheaval half completed, God is cold. The seas are in the hollow of the hand. Oceans may be turned to a spray raining down through the stars because of a gesture of pity toward a babe. Oceans may become gray ashes, die with a long moan and roar amid the tumult of the fishes and the cries of the ships because the hand beckons the mice. A horizon smaller than a doomed assassin's cap, inky surging tumults, a reeling drunken sky, and no sky pale hand sliding from a polished spar, God is cold.
Have you ever heard of the madman who on a bright morning lighted a lantern and ran to the marketplace calling out unceasingly, "I seek God, I seek God"? As there were many people standing about who did not believe in God, he caused a great deal of amusement. "Why, is he lost?" said one. "Has he strayed away like a child?" said another. "Or does he keep himself hidden? Is he afraid of us? Has he taken a sea voyage? Has he emigrated?" The people cried out laughingly, all in a hubbub. The insane man jumped into their midst and transfixed them with his glances. "Where is God gone?" he called out. "I mean to tell you. We have killed him, you and I. We are all his murderers. But now, how have we done it? How are we able to drink up the sea? Who gave us the sponge to wipe away the whole horizon? Do we not stray, as through infinite nothingness? Does not empty space breathe upon us? Has it not become colder? Does not night come on continually, darker and darker? Shall we not have to light lanterns in the morning? Do we not hear the noise of the grave diggers who are burying God? Do we not smell the divine putrefaction? For even gods putrefy. God is dead. God remains dead, and we have killed him. How shall we console ourselves, the most murderous of all murderers, the holiest and the mightiest that the world has hitherto possessed, has bled to death under our knife? Who will wipe the blood from us? With what water could we cleanse ourselves? What lustrums, what sacred games shall we have to devise? Is not the magnitude of this deed too great for us? Shall we not ourselves have to become gods merely to seem worthy of it? There never was a greater event, and on account of it, all who are born after us belong to a higher history than any history hitherto. Here, the madman was silent and looked again at his hearers. They were also silent and looked at him in surprise. At last he threw his lantern on the ground so that it broke in pieces and was extinguished. "I come too early," he then said. "I am not yet at the right time. This prodigious event is still on its way and is traveling. It has not yet reached man's ears. Lightning and thunder need time. The light of the stars needs time. Deeds need time. Even after they are done to be seen and heard, this deed is as yet further from them than the furthest star, and yet they have done it themselves. It is further stated that the madman made his way into different churches on the same day, and there intoned his Requiem Aeternum Deo. When led out and called to account, he always gave the reply, 'What are these churches now, if they are not the tombs and monuments of God?'"
As soon as we lose the moral basis, we cease to be religious. There is no such thing as religion overriding morality. Man, for instance, cannot be untruthful, cruel, or incontinent and claim to have God on his side.
I am determined not to kill, not to let others kill, and not to condone any act of killing in the world, in my thinking, and in my way of life. People kill, and are killed, because they cling too tightly to their own beliefs and ideology, when we believe that ours is the only true faith that contains the truth. Violence and suffering will surely be the result.